Multi-ethnic missions is different than just taking people from different ethnic backgrounds on regular mission trips. And while that might feel like a success to see people from all different backgrounds serving on a trip together, this isn't the exact same thing. And so I want to share a couple of short stories with you to help you understand why is focusing on multi-ethnic mission such an important thing for us to do. The first story comes from Honduras. It's from one of my friends. And she told me about when she decided that she was going to be a longer-term missionary. As she was talking with her church, people in her church came up to her and asked her the question, "Do you hate your family?" And this was not a hyperbolic question. This was a literal question for her. Do you hate your family? Another friend of mine mentioned that when she was going on mission, that her family, she's from a Vietnamese family, her family felt like she was abandoning the family to go on mission. They felt like she was being individualistic just by choosing her own path to go serve as a missionary rather than to follow the business route that her family wanted her to go. A third friend who is coming from the background of Chicago, when she wanted to go on her short-term trip overseas, her church kind of gave her the impression of, well, don't we have enough things right here that need your help? Why would you go across the ocean to help those people over there that we don't even know? In all of these examples, particularly the first two from Honduras and from Vietnam, they have had experience with missions and missionaries. They have received them and not been participants in them, historically speaking. And so, for the young girl from Honduras, she grew up always having churches from the States coming down to help them with VBS. And not that this is a bad thing, but this was just her understanding. Missions is what Europeans and Americans do. They come to my country and they do stuff for us. Not the idea that God wants me to go somewhere else and mobilize other people to be on mission with Him. I had the pleasure to sit down and talk with a missionary couple who were coming back from East Asia. And the wife asked me, "How did I get into missions?" And I recounted a little bit of my story. I said, "You know what? I grew up overseas as a kid. We lived in Scotland. We always had National Geographics. I was just very aware of the world and what was happening out there. My world at 8, I had been to 20 countries and had seen stuff from all over the world at that time. My family always had traveling missionaries. If they were coming through the church, they came over to our house. If there were international students, they came over to our house on a Sunday." And so all of these different points of contact with the international world, my family was part of. Early on, my family got involved in Houston with a group called American Chinese Fellowship, helping out Chinese students that had been here. And so for me, living cross-culturally and being locally on mission was part of who I was. And so when I went to college and God called me into missions, it was a very easy thing for me to go talk to my parents and say, "Hey, guess what? I'm going to go serve as a missionary overseas." Everyone was very supportive, very excited. I turned the question to her, and she had a very similar thing. Grew up with lots of international contact, always had missionaries to the church and to her house, grew up with missionary biographies. And I realized we have two columns of people and their experience in mission. And so in one column, they experienced it from a receiving side. The other column, they experienced it from a sending side. And on this side, it's a very common thing since we're the senders. But now the church is global. The majority of the church's population is no longer in the North and in the West, in Europe and America. The majority of the church, population-wise, is in Latin America, Africa, and Asia. And this trend is going to continue. But within our city, where 1 in 4 people are foreign-born, in our church, where we represent 50 different nations, it is essential for us to understand how do we mobilize people from every walk of life. And so this is what we've been focusing on in the past year. This has led us to reinvent our vision statement for what we do with missions. And this has also led us to start a couple of new programs. One is starting with children. We realized if children are going to see themselves on mission, or if people are going to see themselves on mission, we might have to start with children. And that's what we did. And so we started focusing on sharing missionary stories and biographies in our children's ministry. We focused on bringing up people groups and having people pray, having kids pray for people groups in the children's ministry. We started focusing on talking about world religions with the children. Now this one gets dicey, and some parents were worried. I remember the night that I was teaching on Islam to kids in the church, and one of the parents said, "You know, I'm just a little bit uneasy about this." And I said, "I know, I feel you. I am too." And I looked at the room full of kids and I said, "Kids, how many of you have a Muslim friend?" And every hand in the room went up. And I said, "Parents, those of you adults standing around, how many of you have a Muslim friend?" And I would say probably 30%. So in one generation, we've gone from 30% of us having a Muslim friend to 100% of us having a Muslim friend. And I wanted to make sure that kids weren't just raising their hands to raise their hands, getting into the group action. And so I said, "Kids, what's your Muslim friend's name?" And just across the room, they started calling out names from North Africa, from the Middle East, from Central Asia, from East Asia, all over the Muslim world. And so this is the world that our kids are growing up in. They are forced into these scenarios. I learned about world missions when I was in college, Bible college. I was already very established in my faith, and I had lots of time to think, and I engaged in it when I was ready. My kids go to school with Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists, atheists. That's all of their friend group right there. And so we really started focusing on the kids. We've got some exciting things coming out in January that's going to focus on some art pieces that help our children interactively engage in seeing themselves globally. I don't want to share too much now about that, but that will be coming up in January. But the second thing that I wanted to share regarding this is our First Trip Scholarship. And so this is a little bit symbolic, but the symbolism is important. We want every person to know that there is a pathway for you to go on mission. This is not just for the Euro-Americans to go do missions. This is for everyone to go do missions. It is not just for the haves and not the have-nots to go do missions. And so our church is a multi-ethnic church, and we spend a lot of time focusing on that side. But we have a lot of people here that are in lower income situations, that are in single parent situations, that because of their recent immigration status may not be at their full earning potential situations. And so because of this, not everyone might feel like they have the financial ability to just pick up and take a trip and go on mission. But we want to make that a reality. And so one of the things that we are fundraising for during this Unity Challenge is this First Trip Scholarship. And I hope as you're out walking and talking this week, I want you to talk about a couple of questions. The main one is, what is your experience with mission? Even if you haven't gone on mission or been a missionary, you have experienced it in some way. Maybe you are part of a church that sent a lot of missionaries. Maybe you're from a country or from a context where you receive a lot of missionaries. And so share that with the people that are in your walking group. Now, I want you to do that bracketing thing I talked about in the last video. And I want you to think about, what does it look like from the other person's perspective of, if you had not grown up in this, in the context where you have, how would you see missions? If you had only seen missionaries coming in with European faces, with American faces, if you'd only seen it funded by Western dollars, how would you think missions had to be? And then think now, project a little bit. How can we change this? How can we really bridge this gap from the West to the rest to now we have people from all over the world in our own little community here. And so how can we step into the gospel from everywhere to everywhere? That's one of my favorite missiologists. He's from Ecuador, and that's the title of one of his books, The Gospel From Everywhere to Everywhere. So how do we go from the rest of the West to from the gospel from everywhere to everywhere?